Hello everyone. Today we are back with one of the most easiest algorithm in supervised machine learning, which is KNN, means K nearest neighbor algorithm. The flow for this video will be, first we will understand what do you mean by KNN, then we will see how KNN works, then we will build a model from scratch and understand the hyperparameter in detail. So before we start, here are a few details about DataMonk. In DataMonk, we have students to prepare for different type of interviews and provide study material for their references. If you want to know more about the DataMonk, then you can visit our website www.thedatamonk.com. So let's start with KNN, K nearest neighbor. So first of all, KNN can be used for classification and regression, but it is mostly used for classification cases. KNN is intuitive to understand and easy to implement the algorithm. Beginners can master this algorithm even in the early phases of their machine learning studies. So first of all, what do you mean by KNN? Many a time students get confused between KNN and K-means, but you should remember that KNN is a supervised machine learning algorithm and K-means is an unsupervised machine learning algorithm. KNN is a most versatile algorithm, also used for imputing missing values and resampling dataset. As the name suggests, K nearest neighbor, it considers K nearest neighbor means data point to predict the class or continuous value for the new data point. The algorithm's learning for KNN is, it is an instance-based learning. Here, we do not learn weight from training data to predict our output, but use entire training instance to predict our output for unseen data. We will soon look into the image to understand this point. It is also a lazy learning model. That means that this model is not learned using training data and the learning process is postponed to a time when prediction is requested on the new instance. And it is also non-parametric. In KNN, there is no predefined form of the mapping function. Now let us look into the illustration to understand these points. So in this example, we have a classification problem. We have two classes, class A and class B, and we have to use KNN to predict whether it will be class A or class B. So imagine, like, red and green are our data set and yellow point is our testing data set. We have to predict whether yellow belong to class A or belong to class B. So how do we predict that? We predict that with the help of the K value. So we have to assign the value of K and then see the mode within that circle and predict that whether it belong to class A or class B. So for example, if we have K equal to 3, then this will be our circle for K equal to 3. In this circle, we will tell that we have more data points of class B and less data point of class A. Then we can say that yellow point will belong to class B. But if we have K equal to 7, then this will be our circle. So in this circle, we can say that we have 4 stars of class A and 3 triangles of class B. Therefore, we can say that yellow point will belong to class A. So it will change according to the mode for that circle. And for KNN, there is only one hyperparameter, which is K. And K means that how many data points we have to consider in that circle. Like for K equal to 3, we have considered 3 data points. For K equal to 7, we have considered 7 data points within the circle. So now let us see what do you mean by Euclidean distance. So this is our Euclidean distance and this is the formula for Euclidean distance. So why we use Euclidean distance? So the nearest neighbor are also the data point that have minimum distance in feature space from our new data point. And for K, we have already understood that K is the number of such data points we consider in our implementation of the algorithm. Therefore, the distance metric and the K value are two important considerations while using the KNN algorithm. And one more point which is important for classification and regression is that for classification, we use mode of the data points, and for regression, we use median or mean for the data points to predict the continuous value. So now you understand what do you mean by KNN and how KNN work. So let's build a model from scratch for regression and classification model. So first we will build for regression model. So our problem statement is that to predict the price of a second-hand car based on its feature. So our target variable is price and the predictor variables are age of the car, fuel type and kilometer driven. So our first step for every machine learning is to explore the data. And to explore our data, we have imported two libraries which are pandas and numpy. Then we have read our data, which was stored in our desktop with read CSV function, and then sort that data into our car price data. Then after storing the data, we have removed the duplicate rows, if any, using the drop duplicate function. So as you can see, our one row has been removed because it was duplicate. And then we have printed our head. So this is what our data looked like. And here we have price, which was our target variable, and age, kilometer, fuel type, and HP, which were our predictors. So after printing our head of the data, we have used the info function, which helps us to summarize the information of the data. From this, we can find the data type and missing value of our data. As you can see, our total entries of our data is 1435 rows. And in this, as you can see, age has 1433 rows. That means that there are two missing values. And if there are missing values, which are 30% of the total data entry, then you can remove that column automatically. So after the info function, we have used the describe function. From describe function, it tells us the statistical distribution of the data. And from this, we can also find the unique values, top function, frequency of the data, mean of the data, and quartile distribution of our data, like 25%, 50%, and 75%. So after using the describe function, we have used the most important function, which is the NUnit function. And from NUnit function, we can tell which of our variable is categorical or continuous variables. So as you can see, in this, our fuel type, our HP, matte color, automatic, and door, they all are our categorical variable. And apart from them, all are our continuous variables. Then after finding the categorical and continuous variable, we will see the visual distribution of categorical and continuous predictor using the bar plot and histogram. So first of all, we will see the categorical predictor variable using the bar plot. So to visualize the categorical predictor variable, we have to group the data. So we have written the function which will group the data and show the graph automatically. So we have printed the bar plot for fuel type, HP, automatic, and door as they were our categorical variable. And in fuel type, you can also see that it is divided into three parts: CNG, diesel, and petrol. And in the data, most of our car are of petrol. And same for HP, it is divided into 12 columns, in which car of 110 HP are the most. So after seeing the visual distribution of categorical variable, we will see the visual distribution of numerical predictor variable using the histogram. So we have plotted the histogram for our price, age, kilometer, and weight, where our price is our target variable. So as you can see, in price, we have a positive skewed bell curve. And as for age, we have a negative skewed bell curve. And for kilometer, it is a good distribution, which is around a proper bell curve. But from this distribution, you can also see the outliers. So as you can see, in price at 30,000, there is an outlier, which is totally separated from the rest of the data. And same in weight. We have an outlier at 1400 and 1500, which is separated from most of the data. Then, after finding the visual distribution of a separated variable, we will see the relationship between the variable using the visualization. So, to see the relationship between the two variables, for continuous versus continuous, we use scatterplot. For continuous versus categorical, we use bar plot and box plot. And for categorical versus categorical, we use only bar plot. So, first of all, we have used the scatterplot for continuous versus continuous. So here we have written few statements to plot the graph between price versus age, price versus kilometer, and price versus weight. And in histogram, we have already seen that we have a outlier at price equal to 30,000. So you can focus in price at 30,000, there are outliers. And in weight, which is above 1400, there is also few outliers. So we can treat it for the better accuracy. Then after seeing the visualization between continuous versus continuous, we will see the statistical selection between continuous versus continuous using the correlation matrix. So for correlation matrix, if our value is greater than 0.5 or less than minus 0.5, then it shows that our predictor variable and target variable has a good relationship. So first we have plotted our correlation matrix using the core function. And in this correlation matrix, our first column is only important, as we have to see the relationship between the target variable and predictor variables. So for the first column, we can see that price versus age, there is a minus sign, which shows the negative relationship, and it is 0.87, which shows that it is highly correlated with the price. Same for kilometer, it is minus, so negative relationship,
and 0.56, so also highly correlated. Then we have filtered only those corners where absolute correlation is greater than 0.5 with the price. So as you can see, we have age, kilometer and weight, which are highly correlated with our price. Then after finding the relationship between the continuous versus continuous, we will find the relationship between the continuous versus categorical. So first we'll visualize the data. So to visualize the categorical variable with continuous variable, we have to group the categorical value. So we have grouped the data using the group by function with respect to our door variable. And then we have printed our average with respect to our price. So from this graph, we can tell the average price for each door. So as you can see, for the car of door 2, our average price will be around 8,000. So this will be the average price for each door. And we have already seen that for categorical versus continuous, we can also plot the box plot. So here we can see the box plot for the same graph. And in this, we can also see the outlier. So as you have already seen that, for the price above 30,000, there are few outliers. So in this, you can see the outliers. So after seeing the visualization of continuous versus categorical, we will see the statistical selection using the ANOVA test for continuous versus categorical variables. So for ANOVA test, we use hypothesis testing. And in this hypothesis testing, our assumption is our H node. So from this, we can tell that there is no relation between the given variables. If the H node means the p value is greater than 0.05, that means that there is 5% chance that the given variables are not correlated with each other. And if it is less than 0.05, that means that they are highly correlated functions. So we have written the function for the p value of the ANOVA, and we can see in this graph we have received some value like p value for matte color. We have received 4.45 10 to the power minus 0.5, which is very small in respect to the 0.05. So from this we can tell that matte color is highly correlated with the price. But as you can see in the automatic type, it is 0.19, which is approximate to 20%. So from this we can tell that there is no relationship between the automatic and the price variable. So we will delete this column later on. Then after finding the favorable variables using the ANOVA test and correlation matrix, we will pre-process our data. And to pre-process our data, our first step is to treat the missing values. So first we will print the isNull.sum to see actually how many missing values are there. So as you can see, we have already seen that age has 2 missing value, fuel type has 4 missing value, CC has 2 missing value, and weight has 2 missing value. So we have two options to treat the missing value. First is to delete that missing value. And second is to treat using the interpolation method. So here we will treat it using the interpolation method. For interpolation method, we treat the data of numeric variable separately and categorical variable separately. And for numeric variable, we use the method linear, which means the average between the previous number and the next number. And for interpolation method FL, it means that the first fill. So we will fill that missing value with respect to our previous data. We can also fill the value using the median value and the mode value with respect to numeric variable or categorical variable. Then after that, we will see if there is any missing value left or not. So here you can see we have treated all our missing values. So we will move forward. Then after treating the missing value, our next step is to convert the categorical data into the numeric data. So to convert the categorical data to numeric, we have two steps. First is to treat the ordinal value by manually mapping the numeric variables. And the second is to treat all nominal variable using the dummy variable. So here you can see that we have no ordinal variable and only one nominal variable. So we will treat it by using the dummy variable. So to use the dummy variable, we have a function known as getDummies function. So we have written the function getDummies and our parameter will be the data. So in this, as you can see, our fuel type is divided into three columns: fuel type CNG, fuel type diesel, and fuel type petrol. And the data is divided into the format of 01. Like if our fuel type is diesel, so value will be filled like this: 010. And if it is CNG, it will be filled like 100. And same for petrol, it will be filled like 001. So after pre-processing the data and looking into the EDS, so now our data is ready for KNN. So before using the KNN algorithm, First, we have to split our data into training and testing sample. So basically, we don't use the full data for creating the model. Some data is randomly selected and kept aside for seeing how good the model is. That data is known as testing data. And the remaining data, which is used to build the model, is known as our training data. Typically, 70% of the data is used as training data, and the rest 30% is used as our testing data. So first, we have written the carp as datanumeric.columns for our reference in the predictor. Then we have assigned the values to the target variable and the predictor. In this, our target variable will be price, and our predictor will be the columns of our carp price data. Then after assigning the values to the target variable and predictor, we will split our data in the ratio of 75% as training data and 25% as our testing data. As you can see in our test size, which is 0.25. Then for random set, it is just the number which tells us the combination of picking our data and put it into our training set and the testing set. Then after that, we will quickly check the shape of our training data and testing data set. So from extreme.shape, we can see that there are 1076 rows and 11 columns. And from ytest.shape, we can see that there are 359 rows and one column, as it is our target variable. So now we have split our data into training and testing sample. So now our data is ready for the model. So first we will look into the KNN regression, as we have to predict the continuous variable. So now you can see the code for the KNN. First, we have imported the library kneighbor regressor as we are doing the regression. And in the KNN, there is only one hyperparameter, which is nneighbor, or we can say that it is the K. We have already discussed what the K is. It tells us the total number of neighbor which you have to include while predicting the price of the car. So after fixing the K value equal to 7, so we will fit our data using the X-train and Y-train, and then predict our data using the X-test and putting it into the prediction column. Till now, our model is ready. So we just have to check the goodness of it of our training data and the accuracy of our testing data. So as you can see, our accuracy come to be 81% and our R2 value is 0.6%, which is normal in KNN and random forest algorithm. So here is the data set and here is our prediction. So as you can see, like, our actual price of this car is 9950, but our predicted price is 9613, which is only 3% away from this. So we can consider our model is correct, because our accuracy is around 81%. But for KNN, the most important thing is to select the correct value of the K or N neighbors. So to select the correct value of the N neighbor or K, we use the elbow method. The elbow method has been used to pick a good K value by concentrating on both accuracy and error rate. So first you will choose the K value using the accuracy rate. So here we have written the function where our n neighbor or k value varies from 1 to 40, and we have used the cross validation function to plot the graph between the accuracy rate versus k value. So here is our graph of accuracy rate and versus k value. So from this graph, we can pick the correct value of the k. So as you can see, for k equal to 7, our accuracy rate is the highest, so it will be the optimum value of the K. Then after seeing the accuracy rate, we will choose the value of the K using the error rate. So we have plot the function where our K value varies from 1 to 40 again, and now we will use the error rate. So as you can see in this graph, our error rate is lowest at the value of K equal to 7. So it means that the best value for the K will be 7. So we have built our model on the hyperparameter where K equal to 7 and achieved our accuracy at 81%. So it can be considered as a correct model. So after seeing the KNN regression, now we will see the KNN classifier. So for KNN classifier, we have to use the different data set, as in regression we have to predict the continuous variable, and in classification we have to predict the categorical variable. So we have picked our Titanic survival data set. So we have imported two libraries, Panda and NumPy, and then read the file using the read CSV and store it in our Titanic survival dataset. Then after storing the data, we have deleted the duplicate values, if any. And from this, you can see that there is no duplicate values. Then we have printed the head of our data. So as you can see, this is our dataset where we have passenger ID, survived class, P class, name of the passenger, sex of the passenger, age, and extract class. And in this, we have to predict our survivor class, as 0 or 1, where 0 means that the passenger is not survived and 1 means that it has survived. So to predict the survivor class, first we have to pre-process our data. And to pre-process our data, first we have to delete our useless column, which are passenger ID, name, ticket and cabin, as they are qualitative columns. Then after deleting our data, we have printed our head and you can see that this is our new data set. Then in this data set, we have to remove all the missing value in our data set. So we have used the DropNav for removing all the missing values. So after dropping all the qualitative column, we have to treat the missing value. So for treating the missing value, we can choose two options. First is to drop the missing value and second is to treat the missing value. So for this, we have dropped the missing values. After dropping the missing value, we have to treat the nominal variable. So to treat the nominal variable, we have assigned male equal to 1 and female equal to 0 in our data set. And now you can look in our sex, which is 10001, which means 1 equal to male and 0 equal to female. Then after treating the nominal variable, then we can treat all the nominal variable using the dummy variable. So we have got a function known as getDummies. We have applied it in our data set. So as you can see, we have embarked column which have value like SCSSS. So we have used dummy variable to treat this. Now it looked like this. As you can see, like in the first column, we have embarked equal to S. So it will be like 001. And in second, we have embarked equal to C. So it will be like 100 and so on. Then after treating the data, we have split the data into training and testing data
in the ratio of 75% as training data and 25% as our testing data. And for random set, it is 40. Then we will write the KNN classification model. So first we will import the KNeighbor classifier as we are doing the classification model. And for hyperparameter, in this, it will be same as regression, which has only one hyperparameter, which is k value or n neighbors. And in this, we have assigned our n neighbors as 30 because it is the most optimum value for the k. Now, after that, using xtrain and ytrain, we have fit the data into our model KNN and then using the xtest to predict the value for the prediction. So our model has been created. So we will measure the accuracy on our testing data. So to measure the accuracy for the classification, we use classification report and the confusion matrix. So as for classification board, we have precision recall FN score, where FN score is the harmonic mean of precision and the recall. And our accuracy will be the weighted average of the FN score. So here is the accuracy of our model. If we change the value of our K number, like let's do it 7. So let's see what our accuracy comes. So our accuracy for this comes to be 0.66 and our previous accuracy was 0.67. So after running some tests, that was our best accuracy. And for the confusion matrix, like this is our true negative, this is our true positive, and this is our false positive, and this is our false negative. So from this data, we can predict our precision recall and finally the F1 score, which will give us the accuracy of our model. So here's our data set, where the actual test column is this and our predicted survived is this. This is what we have predicted and this was actually. So as you can see, this is mostly same, but for this case only, as per our accuracy is pretty low for this data set. Then after that, we will use some function to find the optimum value for the K. So to find the optimum value of the K, first we have used the cross-validation function and plot the graph between the accuracy rate and the K value. So from this function, we can see our accuracy rate versus score value. So as you can see, at the value of k equal to 30, our accuracy is the highest. So we have created our model for k equal to 30, which gave us the accuracy as 0.67. And then we will choose our k value based on the error rate. So here is the function. And this, we have plotted the graph between the error rate versus k value. And we can again see that at the k value equal to 30, our error rate is the lowest. So our accuracy will be highest, which is 0.67. So till now, you should know what is KNN and how to write the code for the KNN classification and KNN regression. So now we will look into some real life application for KNN, where KNN model is mostly used. So this is the application for the KNN. The first application for KNN is, it is used in the recommendation systems. Like you can think of the Netflix. There's a recommendation system which tells which movie you should watch or not on based of your preference. Although in the real world, more sophisticated algorithm are used for the recommendation system. KNN is not suitable for the high dimensional data, but KNN is an excellent baseline approach for these systems. Many companies make a personalized recommendation for its consumers, such as Netflix, Amazon, YouTube, and many more. KNN can also be used for semantically similar documents. Each document is considered as a vector, and if documents are close to each other, that means the document contains identical topics. And the third application for KNN is that KNN can be effectively used in detecting outliers. One such example is credit card fraud detection. So like it is a fraud, so it can be treated as an outlier. So that's all for KNN regression and KNN classification. So that's it. Thank you for your time. Hope you like the video. For more amazing content and more algorithms, do like and share the video.